Okay, we are live now. Before I start on the presentation today, I will wait a few moments until the participant count goes up. I see that slowly and steadily you are all joining. First of all, welcome to our webinar. Today we're going to focus on a very special topic, which is environmental and sustainability studies and different study programs here in Germany. You might know me already. My name is Jasmine from my German university. And you see to my right or my left, wherever I am on your screen, my colleague Eileen, also from my German university. In just a few moments, I'll pass it over to her and she'll do a short introduction today and tell you a little bit about my GU. But before we get started, I want to wait until everyone joins and tell you a little bit about the topic and exactly how our webinar will go today. So I'm going to host a short, very brief presentation about studying in Germany, and I won't delve too deeply into the topic of environmental studies and sustainability because I want to leave that to our special guests today. So I will just talk about maybe differences with the German higher education system and maybe introduce you a bit to those of you who are not as familiar. Afterwards, I'll go behind the scenes, turn off my camera and mic, and I will introduce our special guest speakers. So we have a few. First, we're going to have Professor Dr. Thomas Schomerus, who is a professor of public law at the Leuphana Law School. And he's going to be talking about a master in science and sustainability science from the Leuphana University of Lüneburg. And then we're going to have another special guest speaker talking about a program, Gisela Zimmermann. She's a study abroad advisor at the International Office of the University of Nuertingen-Geislingen. Don't worry, I will tell you what those universities are if you haven't heard of them. And if you're not familiar with the German landscape, I'll tell you a little bit about where they are. And Gisela Zimmermann will be talking about the Master of Science in Sustainable Mobilities from Nuertingen-Geislingen University. So before I get started, I want to introduce you to my colleague here, Eileen. She's going to shortly tell you a little bit about my German university. For those of you who are joining us in Zoom, welcome. You can submit questions throughout the entire duration of the presentation by using the question and answer function that is below your screen here. You can do that about any topic you would like. I would ask you to please stick specifically to our study programs today. Shortly when Eileen is doing her introduction, I will share the links to that in the chat. Even though you cannot use the chat, please pay attention to it because we will use it to share some very useful links. And then you can also ask any questions you like to our guest speakers, and they also have access to the Q&A. I want to remind you to take advantage of this incredibly unique opportunity to have direct contact with people from study programs that you're interested in. This is a rare chance, so I'll shortly share the link so you can look at the programs and get your questions ready for their presentations. But first, let me hand it over to Eileen. She'll tell you a little bit about herself and tell you about my German university.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Jasmine, for your introduction. Welcome to another one of my German university's webinar. It's a pleasure to have you here with us and our guest speakers. So I am going to show you a little bit about my German university and our website. So this topic, the topic of today's webinar, like Jasmine said, is studying environmental sciences and sustainability in Germany. And what is my German university? So we are Germany's largest database of English taught study programs. So if you go to our website, www.mygermanuniversity.com, this is the first thing that you will see is our study finder, but you can also click here to have an expanded view. And here you can filter by city, by university, by topic, if you wanna do bachelor's, master's, tuition, no tuition. So you can apply a lot of filters and search for your program here. And for those of you who, like me, are international students, you can find programs in English I am currently in São Paulo, but I have already lived in Germany. I studied at the University of Bremen and Jacobs University. And our team, we put our heads together to write comprehensive articles. We have more than 60 right now. So you can come to our page and click here on articles, and we have articles about many different topics for you, and how you can apply for programs, what are the requirements, how is it to live in Germany, are there scholarships, how to study medicine. So we have a lot of information here, and these articles are really helpful, and I really recommend that you check them out. And we also have our webinars. We have approximately 150 webinars per year, so it's a lot. Every week we have two webinars, and our webinars talk about application strategies. Right now we talk about COVID-19 and how this is affecting studying in Germany for international students. We have subject specific webinars like this one. We have webinars about scholarships, about uni assist, about visa. So make sure to register for our upcoming webinars, and we can answer your questions in the Q&A. And here you can find a lot of information, and we hope we can help you in your journey to go study in Germany. And our team is formed by international people. I myself am from Brazil. We have people from Georgia, from the United States, from Peru, from Germany. So yes, this is our international team, and we have articles in English, in Spanish, and now we are also publishing some articles in Portuguese, and we have webinars in Spanish too, and Portuguese, and Italian, and Russian. So make sure to check out our website and get to know all the features that we can offer you in your journey to come study in Germany. So my German university is based in Hamburg. It's a German startup. And our goal is to help international students find programs in Germany, and help you to learn how to apply and what do you need in order to apply. So Jasmine sent an important link in the chat about our first teacher program, and now I am going to hand it over to Jasmine so that she can talk to you. And I will be in the Q&A answering your questions, and I will also be sending important links in the chat. So make sure you pay attention to the chat as well. Thank you very much. And now I will go in the background.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much for the intro, Eileen. I know you're eager to get into the topic, so I won't take too much time, but just a short introduction about me. For all of those of you who are joining, welcome on Zoom. Again, I see you asking questions already. That's great. Please continue doing so in the Q&A section. And if you're joining us on Facebook and want to be part of the action in Zoom, I did post the Zoom ID so you can join here as well. If not, you can also ask questions by leaving a comment underneath this video on Facebook, and Eileen will periodically take a peek at Facebook and maybe send us any questions that we get from there. So before we get started, a little bit about me. My name is Jasmine, and I'm joining you from Berlin. So I do live in Germany myself. As you can tell by my English, I am not originally from German. I'm originally from the United States. I did move to Germany about 6 years ago in 2015, when I was awarded a research fellowship from the Alexander von Humboldt Foundation. They're a large German funding organization. They typically have funding strictly to PhDs and some postdocs, but they have some funding opportunities for people who have undergraduate degrees, which is why I came to Germany. So after arriving, I did research at a think tank in Berlin for a year and a half on cybersecurity and data protection policy within the EU and the US. And after I completed my research fellowship, I did my master's degree in international relations at the University of Bremen in a shared program with Jacobs University Bremen, which is a private university here in Germany. So I have a little bit of experience with coming abroad to Germany and learning German and being an international student and going through the visa process and finding a program. So while I might not be an expert, I have some experience, and I'm happy to also answer any questions you may have in the Q&A section. So enough about me, let's get started with today's topic. As I said before, I will be very general. I don't want to delve too deeply into the topic, as I want to make sure I save some information for our special guests. So I'm going to give a general presentation about how you can find a program, what types of programs are offered for those of you who may not be as familiar with the German education system. I'll explain that a little bit. And then in the second part of our presentation, we do have our two special guests today, Professor Dr. Thomas from the professor of public law at Leuphana University in Lüneburg, and then Gisela Zimmermann, who is the study abroad advisor at the Nuertingen-Geislingen University. So, starting with how you find a study program. This is probably the most difficult thing for students, because if you're not familiar with universities and you don't want to look at individual university pages, and Germany has more than 400 different universities. So where do you find all of this data? So if you're looking for programs which are taught in German, the first place you should look is Hochschulcampus. So Eileen, if you could please share the link to Hochschulcampus. Actually, you can share the link to the search results for environment or search results for sustainability. You can see here on the screen that there are a lot of different programs available to you. These are German taught programs, so do keep that in mind. If you are interested in English taught programs, yes, there are English taught programs offered in Germany. No, you don't have to speak German to study in Germany. But German is very important, so I encourage all students who come to Germany to learn German, because it can be very useful. The second database you should know is, of course, My German University's Study Finder. We have more than 2,000 English taught bachelor's and master's programs in our Study Finder, and 142 of them are focused on environmental sciences and sustainability degree programs. Okay. So just an explanation, if you're using the Study Finder, students have different priorities when they're searching for a study program. And we do know that many international students are attracted to Germany for education, because Germany is number three in the world when it comes to internationally top-ranked universities. And most of those top-ranked universities, because they're public, they are typically tuition-free. Again, that is not the case, and there are, of course, exceptions, but even if some programs charge tuition, they can be marginally less than other like programs abroad. So if that's important to you, here you can use the filter to look for programs which do not charge tuition, if this is an attractive factor for you. Other ways you can search for programs are English-only programs. We do also feature programs which incorporate some German, so you can, depending on your level of German or English, filter through programs that way. Especially at the moment with the application periods, some of them being delayed because of the pandemic, you can also look for programs depending on when they start in the study semester, and also look for programs that have a current open deadline where you are still eligible to apply. I did mention language requirements. So if you want to study in Germany, you have to have a language certificate in the language you would like to study in. So if you would like to pursue an English taught program, you must have an English language certificate, and that is the same for German taught programs. The only way you can get out of this is if you're a native speaker. Even then, some universities might still want you to provide some sort of verification if you have a previous degree or so on, or can demonstrate you were raised in a predominantly English-speaking country, Australia, New Zealand, US, UK, et cetera. So if you don't have that and you need to provide an English language certificate, You can read about them on our website. We have a very comprehensive and detailed article about the different language requirements, what certificates are accepted, which certificates are not, and universities individually decide which certificates are accepted. So keep in mind that what is okay for one university will not be the same for all universities. So make sure when it comes to specific details about eligibility requirements that you visit the course website of each study program that you're interested in. And where do you find that? We have them already on our website. So we link you to the course websites of all study programs. For our first program today, master's program from Lüneburg, Leuphana University in Lüneburg, I already shared the link. And that's directly to the course website. So back to language requirements. Here you can also filter based on whatever score you have for that certificate. So you can see only programs which you are eligible for. And finally, ratings. I will say that ratings are not that they're not important, but maybe some other countries where they have a very more competitive or well-known university ranking or rating system. Something I think of because I'm from the US is kind of the Ivy League schools in the United States, and they're pretty well-known around the globe and they're quite competitive. That's not necessarily the case here in Germany. But if you are interested in seeing what the nationally or internationally top-ranked institutions are, you can also filter for that on our study finder. But I encourage all students to not pay as much attention to this, because a quality study program doesn't necessarily have to be a top-ranked program. So that being said, the most important tip is to find the right program. Don't be guided just by fees or rankings or names, even by cities. So many students say, well, I have to live in Berlin, or I have to live in Munich. I don't want to live anywhere else. And I really encourage you to look at the right program and not just the right place. I lived in Berlin for 2 years, and then I decided to move to Bremen, which is a smaller city in the west of Germany, close to the Dutch border, and I absolutely loved it. And now I'm back in Berlin, and I won't say that I love one place more than the other. They're just different, and keep that in mind when you're looking at study programs. Don't necessarily be pulled by certain locations or names and things like this. Okay, so where do you apply and what types of universities are there in Germany? How does the system work? Are they all public and free? Are there private universities? So the answer to all of that is yes and no. So Germany typically has two university types. There are more specific details, but to not go too long in my presentation today, I'll just introduce you to two general types. The first one is university, or in Germany, Universität. And the biggest difference to know is that a university has the right to confer PhD programs or doctoral degrees. Some public universities here that you might know, some university types. And this can be also public and private. So for each university type I will talk about, just know that there are public and private institutions of that type. So here on the left-hand side of your screen, you'll see some examples of some universities that you may know that fall under this university category. The second type that you should know is a university of applied science, or Fachhochschule in German. And there are, of course, public and private universities of applied sciences. And again, here on the right hand of your screen, you see some examples of some that you may know. You can also filter for these types on our website, and we explain the differences in an article on our website as well. But what are the overall differences? What do they have in common? And how important is that? So first, what they have in common, they have recognition and they have employability. So many students come to us and ask, well, what's better? What's going to look better on my CV? Should I go to a university or University of Applied Sciences? Which one is going to get me a higher chance of being employed? And the answer is, there is no answer for that. Both universities, university types have that same opportunity for you. The biggest difference is in the learning and teaching style. styles. So I'll get to that in a moment. But as I said here, you can see the biggest difference is that universities have the right to confer PhDs, whereas universities of applied sciences do not. Here you can see the focus. This is what I meant previously with the learning and teaching styles. Universities are typically more research and theory based, whereas universities of applied sciences are more practice based. So it really just depends on what you want out of your study program. There is no right and wrong answer. One university type is not better than the other. One degree is not valid more because you went to a university over a university of applied sciences. It really depends on what you want to do in the future in your career path and what type of learning styles are better for you. So keep that in mind. Okay. Here you can see the general profiles. So when you're searching, we narrow down the length of a program, how much the program is. Keep in mind that I want to explain something here, especially because this is one of the programs we're going to talk about today. So you might be confused if you see free slash 1500 euros. Well, it's either one or the other, isn't it? So there's one very special state in Germany called Baden-Württemberg. And that is where one of our guest universities is in today in this state. And the state of Baden-Württemberg requires a 1500 euro tuition fee per semester for all international students. There are some exceptions to that, and that's why there's a free slash. If you want more details, you can visit the course website directly or visit the Baden-Württemberg page that explains these tuition fees. We also explain it in an article on our website as well. So if you're confused about that, just an explanation. And you can see here the duration, application deadlines, and so on. Okay, so I want to leave my talking to a minimum here. I've already been blabbing for a long time. So I want to first introduce our guest speaker who is going to talk to you today from Leuphana University in Lüneburg. You can see here, I make sure to include a map because I know not many students are familiar with the German landscape. I typically say everything is south because I live here in Berlin, but actually that's not the case today. So if you don't know the city of Lüneburg, it's southeast of Hamburg. So I hope you've heard Hamburg. That's a bigger or more well-known city in Germany. I hope you know that one. It's very easily reachable by public transportation from Lüneburg. And so today's program we're going to talk about, I'll go ahead and give Professor Dr. Thomas Schomero some time to join us. As I said previously, he is a professor of public law at the Leuphana Law School. And today he is going to talk about the Master of Science in Sustainability Science from Leuphana University. So I already shared the link. Professor Dr. Schomeros, if you can turn your mic and camera on, and we'll welcome you to our webinar. Perfect. He's sharing his presentation. I'll go ahead and go behind the scenes and let him take over. And please take a look at the program I shared already in the chat and get your questions ready for the Q&A section. Bye.
Yeah, just me. Thank you very much indeed. And thank you very much for this wonderful explanation where Lüneburg actually is in the north of Germany. Can you see my slides here? Is it open? I hope so. If not, just let me know.
Yes, we can see.
Okay.
We can see.
Yeah. It's it just means that I'm a professor for public law. It's in particular energy and environmental law at at Leuphana University here in Lüneburg. I may seem a bit pale to you, but it is because I'm sitting at the window in my study room at home, and I'm looking out of the window, and the light is coming shining onto me. So. It's not actually how I look like, but whatever. What I'm going to talk to you now is our master program in sustainability science at our university. We have a special faculty here for sustainability. And as Yasmin just mentioned, I come from the law school, but I'm actually a professor at the sustainability faculty. And because when I'm a traditional lawyer, but I came from, yeah, let's say law in practice. I've been working for the, for instance, for the Hamburg government. I've been working for the German federal government and so on. I'm also a judge, so I'm a traditional lawyer. But what I really like and what I really appreciate is working together with other disciplines. And that's why I'm at the sustainability faculty. And what I want to do is I want to tackle the problems we are facing, the global problems, the challenges we have to face now. I mean, as you all know, the challenge of climate change, for instance, which is unheard of. And we have actually, we don't know yet how to solve these problems, but we try to contribute to all of that in our sustainability science faculty, in the subject, in the master program for sustainability. And of course, all of you, I think, have heard of the Sustainable Development Goals. And this is kind of our Bible, you know, it is the frame, it is the basis we work on. And sustainability, you can say, is everything and nothing at the same time. But what we like to do is we like to find ways, we like to find solutions which combine various goals, various targets we have here. And we have these 17 sustainable development goals. And of course, there are trade-offs between these goals, which we have to look at. And so we have a scientific approach here, which we like to, of course, show our students. And as we well know, these challenges, they are really urgent, and we have the planetary boundaries. I've been traveling a lot around the world, and I've taught in various countries in America, in Asia, and so on. And I know about the world. I know how small it actually is. And we want to show you, we want to try to teach you to get a better understanding of the interdependencies of various subjects and so on. So a lot of topics here. What we would like you to become is change agents. You should be the ones who know more, who know better, and to contribute to changing the world towards a more sustainable system. And I think the change agent, this is actually what we want you to be, kind of a global elite who is at the forefront. You're kind of front runners for sustainability. And so this is what our university is looking at. We are committed to contribute to this search for solutions, to strategies to answer, and so on. So, which of course depends on a change of values, on the digital revolution, globalization, and all these topics mentioned here. And so, what we need is an environmental and sustainability approach, and we need a scientific approach. There's so much fake news in the world. And if you look, we're all, of course, on the internet. We all look at websites, and you have your special websites, and others have other websites, and so on. But our approach is different. We have a scientific approach. We are based on evidence. We want to get the proof. And on the basis of evidence, we try to change. We try to change things. In my special field of research in energy and environmental law, I try to find instruments. I'm also an advisor to our German federal government, for instance, and I write laws and so on. And so I think this is quite important. Looking at our faculty of sustainability, you can see that we have two parts here. One is social sciences with the communication sector, policy, economics. And so the other is natural sciences with sustainable landscapes, conservation, biology, and so on, ecosystems, and so on. But there's a combining part, which we name as transdisciplinarity and sustainability ethics, for instance. So transdisciplinarity is more than interdisciplinarity. It means that we look at the world, we look at the people on the street, we ask them, what do you think about it? We are not only kind of locked in our ivory tower, but we are in the world. We are part of the world with kind of sort of real laboratories and so on. We try to change and not just stay at the university. So there's a lot of, for instance, excursions in our curriculum. For instance, with my students every year, I travel to Brussels, of course, not in Corona times, I'm afraid, but normally we visit the European institutions and so on. We have a lot of discussions with politicians and administration officers and so on. So I think this is quite important here. So all this leads to change. Social and environmental changes. That's what we need. So we are here in Lüneburg, the only faculty for sustainability in Germany. Worldwide, there are one or two others. For instance, one is in Arizona, at the Arizona State University. There are not many of them. We come from the traditional environmental science approach. But we said environmental science is not enough. We need more. We need this global approach. We need a sustainability approach here. So what we want to teach you is this an inter and transdisciplinary focus. We want to give you an insight in various subjects. But you also should know about the interdependencies between all these subjects. So you will not become what we call in German Fachidioten, which is subject idiots in English, maybe. But you will have a global and a comprehensive knowledge in the end. I think that's what we find is very important. So new ways of thinking. Of course, we are based on disciplines, on disciplinary fundamentals, but we want more than that. So there's a lot of research at our faculty. We have plenty of PhD students. We have plenty of third-party funded projects and so on. We have several millions every year of project fundings, and we include our students in these research programs and so on. So the basic structure of our program is that we have a major subject, which is sustainability science and so on. And we have complementary studies programs. So you could look at other disciplines, for instance. We also have then, of course, in the end, the master dissertation. So all in all, this is a four semester program, a 2-year program we offer with subjects like natural sciences, humanities, social sciences. But we also have, and what we think is very important, transdisciplinary research projects here. So combining all this together. And so we have various subjects, as I said, in our curriculum, and I won't mention them all here. I mean, you can, of course, you can ask me whenever you like. And but it's all based on the first natural sciences and then social sciences and what is in between. And so you get an approach, for instance, also in sustainable chemistry. So you get an approach to sustainability law, environmental law, energy law, which is my subject, and many other subjects. And you have plenty of choices here. So looking at career prospects, there is not a clear career path here, but our graduates, I would say quite a high percentage stay in research, and they go for a PhD to other countries, to other universities, at our own university and so on. And they're employed by international companies, organizations, and so on. Also, public administration is an interesting employer. For instance, in Germany, we have in many county administrations, we have climate change experts nowadays. And they mostly come, or many of them come from our faculty. So the entry requirements are, you need a bachelor's degree and of any, just a bachelor's degree. And you need some, of course, some knowledge before. If you do not have a completed bachelor's degree, you can also apply, but we will look at what actually you've got. And English language, of course, is necessary because our courses are mainly taught in English. So you don't need any German language skills here, but it is, of course, useful to take German language courses. But we offer them all, of course. Consecutive subjects we have here I think it's a great variety of subjects, from biochemistry or environmental science, sociology and legal studies and so on. So whatever you have in your bachelor's degree, I think we will look at it. And I think most of whatever is possible, we will acknowledge. But I should also say here that we have a large number of applications, and we have many more applications than places for students. So there's a relatively strict selection procedure. I can't tell, I think there are 5, 6, 7, 8 applications for one place. So it's relatively hard to get in our program, but this shouldn't hinder you. I think just go ahead and try. So we look at not only the grades, we also look at your international experience, your personality. Did you do any voluntary work, or did you get any scholarships, and so on? So if you'd like some further information, there's a couple of websites. I think that's also at what Jasmine showed you. And I will, of course, be available for you in the question and answer form here. But also we can, I think we'll have some time to discuss it. So thank you very much for your attention, and I'm looking forward to your questions and further discussions.
Thank you so much for your presentation. That was great. I personally am interested myself in law, and so I find the environmental law aspects more interesting. And I think it's so great that it's an interdisciplinary program, because I mean, students, international students often ask, well, is it better to just really focus on a very specific degree program, or should I pursue an interdisciplinary program. And I'm biased myself because I did an interdisciplinary program in my master's, but I think it's always a great idea to do an interdisciplinary program and kind of have a greater picture view of exactly the topic, but also related topics and things that affects, for example, with environmental studies, not just how that people just think of that, okay, well, to climate change and so on, but also the impacts that has on migration, for example, climate change, refugees, how that's changing the scope and the landscape of our planet. So all of these things affect one another, and they are not just they're interconnected. So thank you so much for this interesting program. I do have some questions. I'll save them for the Q&A, but I did already take a peek at the questions, and I see that I have some that I can kind of present to you during the Q&A session. So thank you so much.
You're very welcome. May I just add that I'm also on the Humboldt Foundation Selection Committee.
And I'm
really glad to see you here as a Humboldt graduate, which is
That's great. Wow. So nice to meet a Humboldtian. That's a lovely coincidence. Great. So thank you so much. First, before we get to the Q&A session, I will introduce our next guest. And then I see we're going to go over a little bit on our time already, but we're very flexible today. So for guest speakers and also for participants, no rush. I'm not going to end strictly at 5. I want to leave time for questions and also give our second guest speaker some time. Maybe that's my fault. I guess I spoke too much at the beginning. Okay, so let's see here. Just one moment. Okay. So now I will present to you our second guest speaker for today. So we have Gisela Zimmermann today, who's joining us. And she's a study abroad advisor at the International Office at the Nuertingen-Geislingen University. If you don't know where that is, I want to make sure that you do, because this is going to be more for students who are not as familiar to the German landscape, who only know like Berlin and Munich. So if you can see here on the map, that's why we include a map. We want students to get to know the German landscape. It is in the state of Baden-Württemberg. It's southeast of Stuttgart, if I can kind of relate it to a bigger city, easily accessible by public transport. I say close to because I'm from Texas, so Germany for me is small, but it's not really close to, but that's just my opinion, to the French and Swiss border here in the south of Germany. And now, let me see. We also have a guest, as another guest speaker who's also going to speak, So we have Julian Bansen. So the both of them today, they're going to be talking to you about our program, our Master of Science in Sustainable Mobilities. And I will shortly share the link for that for you in the chat. So I'll let them go ahead and kind of prepare and turn on their camera and get their mic ready. Perfect, here we go. And then I will share the link. Oh, it looks like Eileen already shared the link. So go ahead and start checking out the program and getting your questions ready. I'll go behind the scenes and let them take over now.
Maybe just a quick word from my side. We have we are two today. It's Julian and me, and I'm very happy that Julian is doing the presentation today, because he is an alumni of our program and he has just finished end of February actually, and I think he's so much into all these topics and content, and I think it's great that he's here today and he's doing the presentation, because I think he might know more about the modules and the content of the program. And I am more the person who is responsible for the organizational questions. Okay, thank you, Julian.
Thank you, Gisela, for that quick introduction of mine. Yeah, I'm very happy to share with you my experiences actually from my personal master's program. I hope you can hear me and I hope you can all see the presentation now. Maybe Gisela just... A quick thumbs up.
Yes,
yeah,
I can
thank
see
you. All right, great. I'm going to present to you the Sustainable Mobilities Masters at Nuertingen-Geislingen University. It's, as already mentioned, a university of applied science as opposed to the previous university. Maybe just another quick word about Nuertingen-Geislingen University. It's actually split into two campuses. One is in Nuertingen and one is in Geislingen. Nuertingen and Geislingen are around 40 kilometers apart, and Nuertingen is around 30 kilometers east of Stuttgart, while Geislingen is about 60 kilometers east of Stuttgart. But that puts it in an even better situation because it is closer to Munich, which is probably the most renowned city down in the south of Germany. And also, maybe one other remark, we are very, very well situated in the economic powerhouse of Germany, which is great for finding internships and job opportunities. You probably all know the large world players in automotive industries who come from this part of Germany: Daimler, Porsche, Audi, BMW, Bosch. They are all situated in close proximity to our university, basically. We also offer different or additional graduate, undergraduate, and graduate programs at our university, which are all in German, but maybe some of you are capable of German, so I'll introduce them to you as well. We in Geislingen are quite famous for the automotive and mobility management master's and bachelor's program. That's also because of our strong automotive industry down south Germany. But we also offer a leadership master's, a real estate management master's, and talking about law, restructuring and insolvency management master's. But sadly, all in German. The English master's is the sustainable mobilities master's, and that's the one to go for you. I'll now go into introducing this and then also the possibilities that we offer within this program. And then I'll go over the curriculum, introduce the very, very interdisciplinary team of lecturers in our course, and then also give you some hints towards employment possibility afterwards. So what can you expect from us? We offer an international master's program in sustainable mobilities, which is ought to transport the key knowledge in the field of sustainable mobility and transport. We really, really take great emphasis on a collaborative and inspiring environment for you. So as opposed to what you might know from universities, we have smaller groups and we offer a lot of group works and collaborative learning. And also our lectures are more like classroom size and with a lot of debate and discussions between the lecturers and the students. Also because of our neat situation, we have direct links to practice and possible employers. All of our lecturers offer a great network of handy people who can bring you into positions afterwards. All in all, the gist of it is actually to give you a kind of a roadmap and tools set to new businesses and better concepts for sustainable products. Sustainable mobility products, I must say. So as I already said, the key competencies in mobility and transport are like, the core, you get it from the name. But also you will learn a lot about urban planning and design, the governance and the legal part of mobility, because of course it's always top down as of now. So you should actually be able to identify where power is in the end and critically assess policies and governance in general. Also, we take pride in actually offering a very problem-based approach, which is usually mainly known from the Scandinavian teaching concepts. So we give you solution-oriented skills, which we think, or actually we know that that's actually more the case if you go into a company and start your work. You will rather be presented with, you know, a problem and you have to find a solution, and we give you the skills to do so. Also, you will be able to improve your speaking, writing, and presenting skills in English naturally, as it is a fully English course. But we also expect things, as I already said, because of this very collaborative setup, we actually need you to be committed and willing to work hard for your own and also for our success, because if commitment is weak, the whole group result, of course, suffers, and also your learning experience suffers. So we're looking for enthusiastic people who have fun in looking into sustainable mobilities, but also who are able and willing to go into teams and do teamwork and get the best for the group and not only for yourself. Also, because we are also fully interdisciplinary, there's a big theoretical part. So reading, studying literature and scripts is important, and also the field of mobility is so diverse and constantly changing, and you really need to read a lot to keep yourself updated. And then, as already explained, active participation in the lectures is actually key. It's not just listening, consuming the knowledge from a lecturer, but also bringing some, bringing your own views. So in a nutshell, we need open-minded, curious, and people who have fun in reading and active participation, and also bold people who dare to speak out their opinion about things, because what we really want to foster, or we actually want to empower you to shape the mobility of the future. So maybe you even want to start reading, and I can only highly recommend start with The Mobile Risk Society by Sven Kesselring. Now the curriculum. As already said, it's interdisciplinary. We have the concepts of social science in the background, and the social science of mobilities, of course, but also sustainable development. You will learn about the SDGs as well. And then that's the left-hand side part, the concepts, and then we have the methods, which is another big building block. So we teach you the methods of how to look into mobility or look at mobility, and how to look at researching the future, actually. There's a lot of action research going on, which directly leads into the practice part, because you will also do research during the semester and learn how to communicate your results in the end. And also you will be collaborating with real organizations from our surrounding. Last semester, I myself was in a collaboration with Porsche AG, and then it suddenly, I mean, you get to understand that the concepts and the methods are fine, but you also have to apply and sell them to the one who in the end is going to set them in place. And all these three building blocks is what you in the end bring together in your master thesis, where you then on your own find a problem, apply social concepts, conduct a method, and then bring it to life. So that also translates, of course, into our curriculum. The first two semesters, or basically all semesters, are a pretty good mix between theory and practice. A good example for theory might be applied philosophy of science. We consider that as very important in the curriculum because it basically gives a basic understanding of how you go about your research in the end. But also it's always this mixture that doesn't let it get boring. You see, we also already have the research methods and mobility solution design in the first semester, so that you have some alternation between dry theory and hands-on project work already. There is a nice excursion. Usually it's to Copenhagen, of course not in COVID times, which is in the second semester in the urban mobility class. And you will also learn in the second semester about the law and governance part of mobility in the third semester as well. And then in the fourth semester, you will have your master thesis, which is the thesis writing in 4 months time, and then also a master's colloquium where you show your knowledge on what you actually did and defend your work, of course. We have 50 partner universities worldwide, so basically you could also decide to study one semester abroad while being abroad in Germany. We recommend, if you want that, to go for Aalborg University, because that's a university we collaborate closely together in the master's program. But I think Gisela can answer questions, if there are any, regarding to that later. Internships. Of course, we support you in finding internships at companies. Ideally, it's companies you already get in touch during your studies. And because we are situated in such an economic powerhouse, it's actually no problem to find them. Albeit, I must say, it has proven a little bit more difficult if you don't speak any German. It's kind of a German thing that German is often demanded from such partner companies. The team, talking about interdisciplinarity, comes from a very wide range of professions. We have urban planning professors, we have pure researchers, we have also professors from other study courses, you know, to foster your understanding of the whole mobility universe, I call it. Some professors, one of our professors is actually also part of the European Commission. Just a nice range of different professions and also age groups. And now the most interesting part, the career opportunities, just as in the last presentation, it's very diverse. And I know from a lot of colleagues who also graduated that they end up in, a lot of them end up in consulting firms or at players in the automotive industry, because also the automotive industry is looking more into this sustainable mobilities part of mobilities. But also at public authorities, e.g. ministries and nonprofit organizations. Or you could actually take up a university position in research like I did and look a little bit deeper into the topic even. And then you can also, but then in collaboration with a university, go on with a PhD. So I hope I got you interested in sustainable mobilities a little bit, and I look forward to working with you.
Perfect. Thank you so much. So as you can see on your screen right now, the contact details for those of you, I saw already some questions about the program and about some certain not eligibility requirements, but some things that may maybe make you stand out on the application. And you can look at these sorts of details directly on the course website. And of course, for more specific questions, you can also contact them by email there. If you'd like, Julian, if you'd like, you could probably copy and paste maybe the email and web info into the chat for the students. Okay, perfect. So you see all of the details on your screen, and shortly you will have them in the chat, so you can maybe save them and contact directly for any questions. So now, again, we're a little over on time and it's not a problem. So for those of you who have questions in the Q&A, I'm going to bring them up now to our guest speakers so they can answer your questions and get you all of the information. And the first question I have here, so I sort of looked at the questions that we all have in the Q&A, and I'm going to put them all together for you both. So all of our guest speakers can, I say, come forward as if you can actually come forward, but a COVID-19 version of come forward, which is just turn your mics on Zoom. And I have some questions for you. So many students ask questions about internships, which both of you spoke of. If you can maybe give a little more details, I saw many questions about internships. Maybe clarify if it's a requirement or not, and regardless if it's a requirement or not, is there assistance in finding an internship, whether in placement or having university contacts? For example, Julian, you did mention that you are located in a very great region when it comes to sustainable mobilities and all of the big partners there. Are there any partnerships that you collaborate with for student internships and so on? And of course, Professor Dr. Chomeros, if you could also talk about that. Thank you.
Shall I answer, Julian? Or yes, it is possible to do internships. It's at the moment easier to get an internship in a city, in a community. It's a little bit easier than to work for the big car manufacturers. But what I would like to tell everybody who is interested in doing an internship in Germany, although, of course, especially in companies like Daimler and Porsche, everybody is speaking English. But if you want to do an internship in Germany, it's still necessary to speak German. So a little bit more than basics, and especially if you want to do an internship in a community, in a city, and the need is big in cities at the moment to get people with the knowledge our students get here in this program. But yeah, you will understand that especially in cities and communities, speaking German is a must. Also writing German if you have to do some research work. So many things need to be done in German. And I think if you come here and you start from the very beginning, Jasmine, mein, your German is really great. And it's always difficult to learn a new language. But I think that some of our students that studied with us in the last years, they missed the chance. They thought they have time, and the 2 years are so quickly over, and then they are looking for a job and they see, I can hardly speak any German, and then it really gets difficult to find a job and before to find an internship.
Maybe I can jump in here. I heard that it is really recommended to reach the B2 level in German, actually, to find employment or to facilitate finding employment. Let's put it a little bit nicer.
For students who, I mean, I hope all of you are familiar with the different German language levels and the same for English. So B2 is a pretty basic foundation of German. And so if you have this level of German, it really opens the door for you. And for those of you who are watching and are interested in English language programs and thinking, well, what? I thought I didn't need German. Relax, you can take German courses when you're here. There are also some free German language resources. Eileen, maybe you could post the link in the chat to the Deutsche Welle online course. It's a free program. I did that before I moved to Germany, and on my first day of my intensive language course, I knew what I thought was a lot. It was just the days of the week. It ended up being nothing that I knew, but it's still really helpful to get some basics for German. And again, even though you don't need German to survive in Germany, that all depends on the city you're in. In Berlin, you probably don't need it. In other cities, it's really important. So also for employability. So I'm really glad you brought up the German, and for internships as well. Even though English might be the working language, you will stand out if you have some German, even if it's very basic German. So thank you so much for bringing that up. Professor Dr. Schomeros, do you want to talk a little bit about some internship opportunities, if it's a requirement, and if there's anything with internship placement and details about that?
Yes, sure. I think basically there's a difference between universities and universities for applied science, because at the University of Applied Science, an internship is normally part of the program. I used to be a professor at such a university years ago, and we had a mandatory internship, which was great. I really loved that. But at the kind of traditional university, it is more research based, and there are normally no mandatory internships, which does not mean that I, for instance, and my faculty do not support this. We do actually, and I would say that most of our students do some kind of internship, and with various institutions, public authorities, international NGOs, and all of that. But it is not a requirement. And I really like that, and we do support that. And regarding English, of course, at our university, or at least at our faculty, English is the normal language. Because much of our faculty, of our staff, is from other countries. So we are pretty much international. We have Americans and Australians and British and I don't know what Spanish is. There are quite a lot of Spanish-speaking professors. And so English is the normal language. And of course, German is useful, but it's not necessary. Regarding internships, it must not be in Germany. An internship, for instance, at the EU institutions in Brussels is very interesting. Or not only at the EU institutions themselves, but at, let's say, an NGO in Brussels, so Climate Action Network or something like that. I think this is there are a lot of possibilities and so on. So once you are here, we will support you in any way, and if you want to, we will find a way to do an internship. But as I said, it might be a bit more complicated, so because it is not a mandatory thing.
Okay, I see. Thank you so much for the information, and I think it's important for students to realize. You can see in the components of the program and the curriculum, how I explained previously, the difference between a University of Applied Science and a university. So it's really just a different learning style. One is not more superior to the other. It really depends on whether you want a practical experience and what's better for you and what most interests you specifically in the topic of sustainability and environmental studies. I want to ask maybe two more questions just because we're already over on time. So I also saw a lot of questions asking about the eligibility requirements. You both went over them, so I really don't want you to have to repeat yourself, but maybe something that goes a little bit more than the eligibility requirements and makes an applicant stand out. Because you both did mention, Professor Dr. Schomeros, you mentioned that it took a competitive program. And so what is going to make applicants stand out if it's a competitive program? Someone asked about work experience, if that's required, or if it's required to have a previous internship. So maybe you could just touch on that a little bit, something maybe that you're looking for in students.
Yeah, it's about about the requirements for admission. As I said, it is not easy to be admitted to our faculty. It's just a matter of the numbers of applications, and it has to do with the attractivity of sustainability science as a subject. but also I would say it has to do with our university, with the city of Lüneburg, where we university is located, which is a beautiful old medieval city. And I mean, coming from Texas, which I know very well, I think you fancy these old real cities. Forgive me, but I know Texas pretty well, and you won't find anything like that. A house in Texas, which is, let's say, 50 years old, is considered very old. But here in Lüneburg, houses are 500 years plus. So, but I think this makes it very attractive, all this. And so so we have, it is very competitive. And as I said, the requirements are, you need to have an undergrad degree, which is consecutive to our master course. And so we look at what have you done before. Of course, we look at the grades, but the grades are not everything. And we look at your voluntary work. We look at we try to look at your whole personality, which is, of course, looking at hundreds of applications. It takes quite an effort, but we try to have a just and fair admission procedure. But I cannot promise any one of you that you will be admitted, of course. But I would say it's worth a try. And we are happy to have international students. I think we would like more of them, more of you. There's a lot of, it has to do with, let's say the German students who apply are mostly have the best school and the best grades in the first, in the undergrad. So we have a lot of, the school, we are somewhat with this with the A levels, what we call Abitur in German, which is a 1A. So it's a perfect A grade, and so that makes it very competitive. Actually, yeah, I have to say this, but I would love you to, of course, to apply, and then we'll look at it.
Perfect. And Julian or Frau Zimmermann, do either of you have some input on, well, students who, of course, you can meet the basic eligibility requirements, but what's going to make you maybe really stand out? Do you have to have some sort of internship already before, or do you need to have work experience? Somebody asked that, if it's necessary to have work experience, if you want to give some input.
No, it's not necessary to have work experience, and I think Julian stressed it very well for us. It's very important that people burn for this topic. That the students are interested in this topic, and that they also know what to expect. So we are not an engineering degree program. So very often, students from abroad, especially from India, maybe they have a first degree in mechanical engineering or automotive engineering, and they know, of course, our brands, our cars, and they expect that we have this content in our degree program. But it's not about this. So students should look at our website and see that it's a social science-based program. It's all about mobility. It's an international program. We like to have international students here in Geislingen. And we also use the experience of our international students in our program. So it's not only about mobility in Germany and in German cities, but it's about mobility all over this world. And we often also learn from our students, because our professors, they know a lot, but they do not exactly know how it works in India or in Thailand or in all these countries. And this makes it, in the end, I think that we all learn from each other, and that it's a nice mix in the end. And one requirement when students applies to write a motivation letter why they want to study our program. And from this motivation letter, we see right away is the expectation the correct one or not. And sometimes then we get back to the applicants and say, listen, nice that you want to study our program, but it's about this. And if you think this is the right choice for you, then we are happy that you apply and maybe in the end take you. I don't know, Julian, do you have anything else to add here?
Yeah.
We're still a pretty new program. So we have a good number of students. It's always between 15 and 20. So 20 is the limit, but it's still a new program. And as I said, we learn not only from semester to semester, but we learn from each other. And it's a very current topic. So it's all about mobilities everywhere at the moment. And also within Germany, it's progressing. The whole mobility scene is progressing. And it's fun to watch this and to be part of it.
Thank you so much for that input. You're absolutely right with the mobilities progressing, and especially sustainable mobilities. And so I have one final question for you all that I saw in our Q&A section, and that was about doing a semester abroad or partner universities. Frau Zimmermann, you did already mention, you talked about sustainable mobilities around the globe and how it looks different than maybe in Thailand or in India. So what if students want to maybe research that as part of their studies and look at sustainable mobility infrastructures around the globe? Are there opportunities abroad? You did mention one partner university, but do students have other options? Professor Dr. Chomeros, you can maybe also touch on that. So anyone can start if you can talk about maybe opportunities abroad or maybe partner universities, whether for an internship or a semester study program.
Mm-hmm. I think we are flexible when students go abroad, and this is also unique at our program because there is no other program what we know what is completely the same. So we are not in competition really with other programs what the content is concerned. But when our students go abroad, we give them the possibility, and then they are also a bit flexible. If they say, okay, we are more interested a bit in urban planning topics or in not engineering and yeah, what fits to our program. We have a look at the program abroad, and if we think it makes sense that students have this knowledge as well, then they get the chance to study this abroad. Yeah, like environment, as I already said, urban planning, city planning. So it's a big topic, and as I said, in the semester abroad, they achieve maybe around 20 ECTS very often. And if this is not exactly the same of what they get here, this is totally okay for us, because students also decide where do I want to specialize and do I want to be in the future? Where do I want to work in the future?
Yeah, I might just add that, as I already mentioned, we have various international universities as partners, and we support a semester abroad in any possible way, of course, and it's not a requirement, but it depends a lot on what you would like to, what kind of subject you would like to deepen in your studies. And so we have offers, let's say, in Spain and Barcelona, in Sweden, in Karlstadt, in the UK, in various countries, of course. But we look at what would you like to do, and we make it easy for the recognition at our university. So Frau Zimmermann mentioned like 20 ECTS, so credit points, which is also common for us, and 20, maybe even a bit more, depends. But the major thing of going abroad is, of course, for our German students to get international experience. If you, as an international student studying in Germany, go abroad, I think it's about getting experience in another country than your native country. But I mean, we are open to any kind of ideas and so on. As I said, we have an international office, which is very supportive, and there shouldn't be a problem. And there's a very intensive, process to give you advice on it. And so there's a long discussions beforehand. So we really like to support it, but we want you to find your way and your individual way. What is your what is your goal in life? What do you want to achieve? And so everyone has a different goal and a different way. And this is what we are for, to support you in that and to be successful in the end.
Thank you so much, both of you, for your input. I think I'm going to wrap it up now. We've gone 20 minutes over, but that's, again, fine. So thank you so much for all of our participants for today. I see some questions still there. Please don't worry. You have all of the links that you need in the chat section. And you have the course websites. If you have any further questions, you have the contact information from the course websites of each program today. For more general questions about studying in Germany, very general visa and scholarships and so on, you can go to our website. We have very detailed articles about these topics. Many of you asked about Studienkolleg and so on. But for detailed questions, you can, of course, always message us, whether it's on Facebook or Instagram or send us an email or what have you. Thank you so much for all of our guest speakers today. We will forward any questions and inquiries we get from students to you. And we'll chat shortly afterwards. I won't make it long, I promise. I know we're already over time, but I'll see you all just shortly in our feedback round. And so I will forward students who attended today all of the materials from this presentation, all of the links and the presentations from our guest speakers, as well as the presentation we use today in the next week. So thank you all so much for attending. Thanks, Eileen, for moderating. And we hope you have a wonderful rest of your day or evening, and stay healthy out there with the pandemic. So bye.
Bye, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.